Okay, welcome everyone. This is a dual event. It is our Rockefeller internship class, as well as an open event. We advertise to other students about a graduate school. It's graduate school for me. So my name is Joan Marceau. I'm the internship coordinator for Rockefeller College, and Taylor Browning, who is one of our GAs in the office, is here as well. And we also have with us tonight Jaclyn Napoleon, who is the Director of Admissions for Rockefeller College. And she's here to talk about graduate school, specifically Rockefeller College graduate school, but also just graduate school in general, how to apply to graduate school, kind of what you should be thinking about. And she's here to answer questions. So she has a presentation with some PowerPoint slides, but we love to have questions. So if you're in the room, go ahead and raise your hand and we will call on you to ask questions. If you're on Zoom, you can go ahead and use the raise your hand feature to ask questions. If you're not able to unmute yourself to ask questions, you can also type them in the chat. Taylor will be watching the chat and asking any questions as well. So with no further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Jaclyn. Let me spotlight you and then you can go ahead and get started.
Great. Thanks, Joan. Hi, everybody. Thanks for letting me crash your class tonight. This is always fun for me because I, as Joan said, I oversee graduate admissions for Rockefeller. So most of you know, if you're a political science or public policy major, we are your academic home at UAlbany. And so I oversee just the graduate program admissions process. So for any of you considering master's degrees, PhDs, graduate certificate programs here at UAlbany through the college, I'm your gal. So but I'm going to talk more generally about graduate school tonight because you may stay here, which is awesome. We have some great, you know, combined. Decide to go elsewhere, or you may have a different plan. So we'll talk a little bit.
Jaclyn?
Yeah?
You're freezing a little bit. Can you repeat from combined programs on, repeat that part. Let's see how.
Sorry about that. You know, this always happens. Like in the middle of a presentation, you're like, internet gets weird. So we have a whole lot of graduate programs right here at UAlbany, but some of you may be considering other graduate programs. So I'll talk a little bit generally as well about what some of the options are and what you might want to think about as you sort of think about what's next. So I'm going to share my screen and I'll show you what I have to see. So hopefully you can see that.
Yep.
Okay, great. So the first thing that I always encourage students to think about is, what do you want to do and how do you decide? And I just love this graphic because I think it intersects the things you want to most think about. You love this thing, you're passionate about it, you hope that the world will need this thing, whatever it is, you're good at it, somebody will pay you to do it. And that's sort of where all of the things intersect to find sort of an ideal career or profession. And you might not have all of these things all at the same time, all the time, but if you feel like, you know, you're really able to contribute and you really love what you're doing, you know, I think there's no bad decisions. And you've all started that process anyway, being part of Rockefeller and choosing majors that really change lives, that can sort of change the trajectory of government, of policy, et cetera. So you're already on your way. So good for you. There are lots of ways that you can decide to change the world through graduate school. So some of you might be thinking about law school, and I'll talk a little bit more about law school in a second. But some of you might be thinking a more traditional academic path. Perhaps you're thinking more of a theoretical master's or a PhD even. But perhaps you're thinking about a professional degree. Perhaps some of you don't know what a professional degree is. And you're lucky enough to be an undergraduate at a graduate program, which is among the top 10% best graduate programs in the country for the MPA, which is the Master's of Public Administration. We'll talk about that in a minute. But it also includes things like a Master's in Public Health, a Master's of Social Work, a Master's of International Affairs, which we also have at Rockefeller. And so they're slightly different things, all of these degrees. Many of you may think law school, what do I do with a political science major? I have to go to law school. Not at all the case. There are some really other great opportunities besides law school. I think law school is great for the right student who knows that they want to write a lot and research a lot and spend a lot of time committed to a graduate degree, but it's expensive and it's time consuming. And you know, the job market is less predictable with law school. I think one of the things that I always encourage students to take a look at a professional degree, because it sort of combines the best of both worlds. You learn how to research and how to write, but you also learn really professional practical skills of how to, you know, how to create a memo in terms of taking policy and paring it down to a way people can read it. You're going to learn how to make decisions. You're going to learn how to manage budgets. And these are all the kinds of things that a professional degree can teach you. And so the point of a professional degree, you take it and you go into the job world. You have a career waiting for you. That's sort of how it's designed, which is a really great thing, I think, about the professional degree. Not the only degree or not the only option, but certainly one. Law school also prepares you to go on into the work world, but it is a much different landscape in terms of the kinds of, you know, kinds of law you practice, the kinds of environments you're in, the public, the private sector, et cetera. So there's lots of things to consider. So those are the things that I always encourage students consider. You might, one of these jumps out at you, one of them, you might not, you're like, oh, law school was all the only option I thought I had. And now maybe you're like, huh, let me think about what some other options might be. And think ahead. I won't read all of these. You guys can read, but I think the big ones I'm gonna highlight are, luckily you've done these, you're doing an internship, and hopefully you're familiar with your career offices. I know you are, because Joan does a great job of making sure you're all aware of the opportunities that you have. I mean, not only are we insanely lucky to be in Albany, but you know, we have a lot of students who are in DC or going to DC or have gone abroad. I mean, there's so many ways to take advantage of the opportunities you have to figure out what that next step is. I'm sure many of you have participated in student organizations. Perhaps you have developed relationships with your faculty. I can't emphasize that enough. They become really important if you think about graduate school. They become essential in terms of writing letters of recommendation. So if you haven't gotten to know at least one faculty member relative, and if you have to take any of the standardized
Jaclyn?
Sorry?
You're freezing again.
Oh no, I'm sorry. I don't know why.
Okay, you were doing really well for a while, so keep
I'm not
going.
Getting any. I'm not getting any weird internet messages. So, so I will. So anyway, you guys can read this slide. So I won't. I won't repeat myself. The other things that I will, actually, the one thing I didn't mention, I apologize, is taking quantitative classes. And so for those of you, particularly political science majors, because you don't have the same requirements as our public policy students do, I cannot emphasize enough, take a statistics class, take a microeconomics class, take a college algebra class. These are the kinds of classes that will give you some of those essential skills you need to be successful in graduate school, whether it's law school, professional school, or anything. Analyzing data is incredibly important, and you need those skills to be able to sort of move forward. So I, like I said, I can't emphasize it enough. Take RPAD 316. It's a statistics course taught from a social sciences perspective. So you're not taking it in the math department. You're taking it from a perspective slightly different. So those are the kinds of things I think it's really important to think about if you haven't done so already. And then some of the things as you're looking at programs are important. Location might not be important at all. You're like, I'm going for the program, so that's not important. Great. Look at the programs, what they offer, who's teaching there, what kind of jobs are students getting. You know, you're not, you look at that as an undergrad, but it's less of a focus, I think, as a high school senior than it is as a graduate student. You want to know where alumni are going, what they're doing. One of the great things about Rockefeller is we can sort of brag on this pretty well, since just about all of our students have jobs by the time they graduate out of our graduate programs, because they just prepare students incredibly well. And you get a combination of the classroom as well as the professional experience. Be realistic in your expectations. Certainly if you're a 4.0 student, chances are you'll have lots and lots of options. But if you're in that 3.4, 3.5 range, you probably still will have a lot of options. So don't worry too much in terms of, oh gosh, I had that one C freshman year. It's going to ruin my ability to get into graduate school. It's not the case. You know, we understand as admissions direction and path as to how they get there. You know, one bad grade isn't going to set you back. So if you are taking a GRE, which is sort of the college level version of the SAT, perhaps graduate schools require it. You're sitting for the LSAT because law schools require it. Make sure you find out how much that score matters. It's important. And then think about your internship and work experience. It's never a bad thing, ever. It's always going to be good to take advantage of having the experience. However, it's not necessarily required of programs. So you want to make sure you ask that question. So here at Rockefeller, as I mentioned, and how I talk about these programs, there's lots of programs like these. You're lucky enough to have one of the best ones on your campus in the state capital. So it's sort of a nice, perfect storm of opportunities for you. And then I'll talk a little bit about the combined programs that we have too. But most of the things I talk about, you know, this is what these degrees are, no matter where you're looking for graduate school. And so what is a Master's of Public Administration? What is a Master's of International Affairs? What can I do with an MA in political science? These are the things that you can do. you know, you want to make an impact. Maybe that's at the local level. You want to be part of your county legislature. You want to be part of your state government. You're interested in going to the federal level. You just want to be an advocate. You want to be part of a nonprofit organization that makes healthcare better for kids. You want to make education better. You're interested in working with immigration policy. You're a student who really wants to be part of creating and making things better for other people. And that, I think, is ultimately what these degrees do, whether that's domestically here in the US or perhaps it's internationally. You know, we have students who certainly stay here in the States, but we have people who go all over the world to do this kind of work. And these graduate programs are specifically designed for this type of work. So if you know you want to go out there in the public sector and change the world, these are the degrees that can do that. So some of sort of the examples of things that you can do from federal, state, and local government to nonprofit organizations and private industry. You know, the public sector makes sense, government, policy, all that good stuff, nonprofit organizations. But the private industry, they all have ties to government and they all have ties to things like regulation. And they have ties to, you know, all different kinds of government affairs and liaisoning with what policies are current. What are the things that private sector organizations need to keep in mind when they set their own policies? So there's a lot of opportunities, not only in the public sector, but also in the private sector. And our students are really across the board in all of these things. So our master's programs, again, they'll be similarly structured, you know, at other types of graduate programs, but these are the ones that if you're thinking about doing this kind of work are the ones to consider. So if you're thinking about perhaps an international career, you know, you're really passionate about working, making people work between countries, among countries, you want to look at things from a really global perspective. How do international organizations work? How do international governments intersect and work together? How can we create a, you know, diplomatic experience among two countries that maybe don't get along so well? Perhaps you're interested in security and making sure that we're safe, they're safe, whoever is safe. Perhaps you want to do development. The Masters of International Affairs is a program that can really, you know, obviously provide you with not only the classroom experience, but like our master's degrees, they do offer a 400-hour internship experience. So you have to do this professional internship before you graduate. And the same can be said for the Masters of Public Administration, the MPA. And that offers concentrations. If you really want to, you're like, I know I want to start my own nonprofit. I want to manage a nonprofit to do X. I really want to be part of creating an experience for this population or this population. Maybe you're like, no, I know I want to work in government. I want to work in policy. I want to work in budget. I'm interested in working in the Department of Labor or Education or what have you. That's the kind of program you want, something within public management. If you're just really excited about policy and really learning policy, researching policy, creating policy that is effective, the MPA is a great way to go for that. And same thing with things like security, more so on the domestic level, but you can also take international affairs courses with the MPA. So there's a lot of really exciting opportunities within both of these master's degrees. And again, you're getting that professional career experience built right into the master's degree. The MA in political science is a little less structured in terms of the kinds of, you have lots of electives you'll take. You can sort of cater the program to your interests a little bit more. We usually recommend students do an internship, but it's up to you. But if this is something you're interested in, you really want to do campaigning and elections or lobbying, you're really interested in how the law intersects with democracy and justice, you know, the MA might be a great opportunity for you. So lots of really great choices. And we offer a combined program, as I mentioned that here. So what that means for those of you who are juniors, and really even seniors, believe it or not, if you've got some coursework still left in your degree, the beauty of the combined program is that it allows you to apply typically about the end of your junior year. That's sort of the traditional timeline, but there's some flexibility there if we need it. And so you apply and get admitted to the master's degree as an undergraduate, and you're able to take 3 to 4 classes in the MIA, MPA, or MA. And each one of those courses double counts to your undergraduate major. So you're taking a 500 level course, but it's fulfilling perhaps a 300 level course that you also need to take in your undergrad major. So it's a great way to get a full semester's worth of credits done at the undergraduate level. And you're also paying the undergraduate tuition rate. So you may not realize, perhaps you do, is the graduate tuition rate is twice the undergraduate tuition rate. So you're saving a significant amount of money by doing some graduate coursework and paying the same tuition you've been paying. So it really is a great value for that. And then by doing so, it accelerates the program. Our MIA and MPA are typically 2 years. You can do them in a year and a half. And the MA, you can do in one additional year. And there is even some flexibility in there, depending on if you decide to take summer courses and things like that. So you can really put together an amazing bachelor's and master's degree program, 5 years, 5.5 years, have had professional internship experience, and off you go into the career world. So the great thing about these programs is it gets you started and gets you in the door. And then if you take these courses and you're like, wow, I love these, this is what I wanna do, awesome. If you take these courses and realize maybe this isn't the direction I wanna go, that's okay too. They're still gonna count toward your bachelor's degree. So it's a sort of a win-win for everybody. There are some requirements though. We do require a 3.2 GPA. And then back to those quantitative courses I mentioned, there's a lot of statistics you have to do in some of these programs. There's some, you know, you're going to use a lot of statistic databases. You're going to analyze data. You're going to use some of these elements of microeconomics, of college algebra, not extensively. You're not going to be doing, algorithms and stuff on a daily basis, but it's a really essential skill set. And so we want to make sure students have been exposed to that during their time here. So for those of you thinking, hey, maybe the combined degree is a good idea for me, this is a quick snapshot of sort of how we recommend students apply to the program. That way, you know when you get your decision, you know when the deadlines are, et cetera. So the MA is a little more flexible. You could apply to that now if you wanted to. The MPA and MIA, we usually cater to the end of junior year, as I mentioned, but maybe you're graduating early. Maybe you've got a ton of credits. Let me know. We can talk about sort of some of the deadlines that go along with that. If you're a senior, you could still apply. You know, if you have a few courses still left in your bachelor's degree that you need to complete, go ahead and apply by December 1st. And we could, even if it's not all three or four classes in the spring, perhaps you just want to get started in one or two, you can do that as well. And then the checklist of the application. The good news is obviously your transcripts are already here. So that's easy. You don't have to do anything too painful. You just have to fill out the application. And then I'm sure you all have amazing resumes ready to go because Joan has been helping you and Taylor. And then it's really just about a personal statement of this is why I think this might be a great career for me. What are some of the things I'm looking to learn? What are the questions I'm interested in asking? And then there are those letters of recommendation I mentioned. So it's really important to get to know your faculty who you feel like can speak to your ability to be successful in graduate school. These are all important things. For those of you who are interested in applying the regular way, perhaps you're graduating in May and you're like, I'm good to go, I'm just gonna graduate, and then maybe I'll consider graduate school. Great, you know, we're more than happy to do that. That's how most of our students come to us, although we do have the largest combined degree program on campus. So a lot of students take advantage of the combined degree. So I certainly encourage you to at least think about it. And if you have questions, reach out to me, but you certainly can apply the regular way. As a lot of our students do. We're lucky to have, like I said, one of the best programs in the country right here at UAlbany. And you're paying, you know, a SUNY graduate tuition, which is significantly less than any of our peer schools. And you are almost guaranteed a job. I mean, that's really how impressive these degrees are. Our students are placed at about 98% employment within 9 months of graduation. So it's a pretty impressive group. And sure, a lot of those people stay here in Albany and work in state government. But like I said, we have students who work all over the world and are really doing amazing, you know, life-changing, world-changing work on a daily basis. So it's an exciting time, I think, in not only the US, but around the world to take advantage of experiences like this. And then this is just a sort of very, very quick snapshot of some of the places our students work, intern, et cetera. Obviously, we have a very, very good pulse on New York State agencies. Those are our bread and butter. But, you know, we have everyone from the Department of State to the UN to working in the New York City mayor's office to working for senators and congressmen and women. We have people who have interned and worked in the Smithsonian at the White House. I mean, you name it. Joan can carry on with this list because it's an impressive one. Our students go on to do some really exciting things. If you're passionate about, you know, environmental issues, and we have students at NYSERDA, the NRDC. I mean, there's just no limit because there's so many opportunities. This is a real growth industry. It's established in terms of, yes, you're always gonna have the public sector, but you're always gonna need people in the public sector. This industry is not going away. You know, there's not something coming along next that's gonna take over for it. So these are, you know, we need really good, strong students who are willing to work hard and be a public servant. And so here are some titles. Sometimes people are like, what do you do in the, you know, division of the budget? Because it can be it can be a little misleading sometimes, I think, as I'm sure you're getting to know through your internships. If any of you are in the Thinking Ahead class, you know, if you're learning about some of these departments and agencies, they sort of can sound confusing. What do you do in that? Okay, it's called the Department of Health. Does that mean every single thing I do has to do with health? No, there's all kinds of different jobs within different agencies and departments. So it's important to keep that in mind and to not, you know, sort of say, okay, the only thing I want to do is be a Foreign Service officer and that's it. I promise you there's probably 10 other things that you can apply that same skill set, get a similar kind of international experience, and still be able to really make an impact in the world. So I always encourage students to keep an open mind as you're in your internships now. You're getting a really cool glimpse into how things work day to day. And you're going to get that on another level with a master's degree, because you're going to really become a true professional staff member. You know, you've done your bachelor's degree, you're a master's student now. And so what you're doing is sort of that next level stuff. And so we were really excited for students to be able to take advantage of that. And we have the amazing, you know, statistics to back it up in terms of how well our students do being placed in really exciting jobs, you know, around the country and around the world. So I know that's like a lot of information in a very short period of time, but I certainly invite you to stop by and see me anytime. I'm on the downtown campus in Milne Hall if you're ever wandering through, but I also have Zoom office hours every week. And I really encourage you to, you know, keep it in mind, and keep, whether it's graduate school with us or graduate school somewhere else, I really encourage you to think about ways that you can go out and change the world. And a lot of times a master's degree is the way to do that, because it can be hard with a bachelor's of political science or just a bachelor's in public policy. A lot of times people want to see that next level work, and the MPA, the MIA, the MA will really allow you to do that and say, okay, I've done this extra work and I've done this internship and I've got some really meaningful experience to bring to the table. So I'll open it up for questions now, but I thank you for your attention and sorry for the internet glitches, the world we live in now, I suppose. So so I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Excellent. Any questions in the room here about either the Rockefeller programs or grad school in general, or the application process, or things you could be doing now? If you're on Zoom, feel free to raise your hand and unmute yourself. And we love it when there's questions.
I know, because there's always something I miss. And then I'm like, oh yeah, that. Actually, while you're thinking, there is one thing I just remembered. Because a lot of times students, if you didn't get the chance to study abroad, for instance, at the undergraduate level, you can do that at the graduate level too. So there are opportunities not only to do one semester abroad as part of a graduate program, but we actually have a dual degree program with Bocconi University in Milan, Italy. So not a bad place to stay for a year while finishing a graduate degree. And you can actually get 2 degrees through that program, for instance, and that's a very internationally focused program. So that's kind of a neat opportunity. We also have the JD MPA with Albany Law School. And so if you're like, I know I really want law school, but this MPA sounds really like it could be helpful for me, you actually can put the 2 degrees together and finish them totally in 4 years instead of 5. And so you can accelerate that process as well. So there's lots of options.
Excellent. Questions?
Can you take grad school courses without applying for the program in case you're not too sure? Yes, I'll say yes, you can. Typically what I'll have you do is, you know, talk to Zahar, talk to your advisor, make sure, you know, that's a good fit for you. Typically it's fine. I know we've given students permission to take graduate courses in the past. So yeah, if you're like, hey, I'm registering for the spring soon, is there the ability for me to take a course? You know, typically you want to be a really strong academic student, which I'm sure you are. So yes, the short answer is yes, but I would definitely talk to Zahar about that.
All right, Oswaldo, go ahead and unmute yourself.
I'm not sure if you have the answer, but what's the average salary of people that end up with the MPA?
Great question. I should have mentioned that, because it's pretty good. It depends a lot on where you are, you know, because obviously Albany will be different than New York City. But for most of our students, at least in Albany, you're looking at close to $60,000 a year with a master's degree. And then in New York City, that could be upwards of $70,000 or $80,000. So not always, and not in every situation. Those tend to be government jobs. Those tend to be private sector jobs tend to be even higher. Nonprofit organizations might be slightly less, depending on the nonprofit that you're working for. But overall, they're about, I want to say the statistics, right about 54 to 55% higher on average than someone without the master's degree. So it's a significant bump by doing the master's degree. What are some of the careers you see MIA graduates attaining here in the US and abroad? Yeah, so we have MIAs who've done a little bit of everything. We have some here working in state government, doing security work, doing homeland security work. We have some MIA, we have an MIA who works in, who is in Cambodia, I believe he works there. We have some MIA students who have done some interesting work. Oh, what is the New York State Department of Homeland Security, as I mentioned. So they've sort of been all over. The MIA has been, is a newer program. We're entering our sixth year of the MIA. So we have a fairly small cohort, but students have gone on to do a whole bunch of really interesting things. We've had students work at the UN. One of the cool things about the MIA is that their internship experiences and their capstone obviously tend to be more global. So we've had students who interned with the Department of State. We have a capstone program with the United Nations Development Fund where students actually can establish where grant money goes from the UN. And we've had students placed in those similar positions in US full-time students. So they've sort of been all over. And we also have some students who are sort of in that process where perhaps they stayed in Albany to start with the state process and are now going through the Foreign Service process, which is a process. And so there's a whole bunch, they're kind of all over. If you've done internships throughout your undergrad, but they're not entirely relevant to the master's program you want to apply, is it still valuable for admissions? Absolutely. Just because you haven't done an internship directly related to government or policy, you've still done work. You still have learned what it's like to exist in a working environment, to be a professional accountable for something, whether literally that's working at Starbucks or writing policy. You have responsibilities to you, to others. You're learning the dynamics of a working professional. You're learning how to make decisions. You're learning how to navigate an environment that is different from school. And so all of that experience is valuable. Like I said, when I worked in undergraduate admissions for a long time, and I loved seeing students who just had part-time jobs because that was a unique experience that was very different from a sports team or a student organization. You know, having a job is a different experience. So whether it's an internship that's in the state capitol or it's an internship, you know, at a public relations firm, you know, or something in between, it's all very valuable. So yeah, there's nothing that would in any way have a negative impact on admissions. Good question.
Excellent. Any questions in the room? Any more on Zoom? All right. Well, I want to thank everyone. I do want to say one thing, but I have to take a drink of water. So Jaclyn mentioned one of the pieces in the application process is a personal statement. And I know in our class tonight, we're working on cover letters, which is not exactly the same thing as a personal statement. And so I will tell you that we do have handouts available in our office, and you can meet with Taylor or Emily, our other graduate assistant, for help with personal statements as well. There are a little overlap to a cover letter, but there's some other things that you want to be sure when you're writing a personal statement. So just know that you can get assistance with that process as well through our office if you're applying to either Rockefeller or another graduate program or law school.
And I'm happy to be a resource for that as well. You know, if you have a draft and maybe you're not applying to us or applying elsewhere, you know, I'm more than happy to take a look at that too.
Excellent. All right. Any last questions? All right. Well, I want to thank you so much, Jaclyn, for joining us. And I assume you'll share your slides as normal, and I'll post those on Blackboard. And
I will send those to you tomorrow. Great. Thanks, Excellent. Everybody.